Thank you, David, again. And next we have Dr. Lauren Diepenbrock. Lauren Diepenbrock is an assistant professor of entomology at CREC, and she will be talking about pests in the backyard.
Just get myself unmuted. Hopefully you can see my screen just fine. I'm doing this on a laptop that I don't normally do this on. Also, please let me know if you have any problems hearing me. I'm in a hotel room, not a normal place for me to be presenting. Good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk to you today about some of the insect and mite pests that we hear a lot about in the home landscape. A lot of these are the same things we see in the grows. It just has to be handled a little bit differently in dooryard. And if you have any questions or if anything else weird pops up, feel free to reach out. I'm happy to try to help you. If I don't know the answer, I'll try to figure it out. So Fernando was kind enough to already mention our cute little Asian citrus psyllid here. They are beautiful, but they are horrible. They are a small mobile hemipteran pest. So basically that just means they go through a bunch of molts. So there's juvenile stages of it. They have piercing sucking mouth parts. So they put their little mouth parts into the plant when they're feeding on it. And they move around the bacterium that causes citrus greening. So when they ingest food, they also spit up a little bit into the plant, which sounds really gross, but their spit up also has some of that bacterium in it, and that bacterium can then get into the plant and proliferate and cause damage. Not every Asian citrus psyllid carries the bacterium. It all depends on if they picked it up or not. But we tend to treat them all like they're hot because we don't want to have greening anywhere unnecessarily, which is a little easier said than done. So as I said, they infect the plant with bacterium associated with citrus greening virus. We can also have, under heavy infestations, we see a lot of damage to the plants, where they can actually stunt the plant's growth. How do you find it? Normally when I get a picture from somebody and they're not sure what they're looking at, it looks like the picture on the bottom there with the white waxy tubules. When they feed as nymphs and as adults, they produce this waxy exudate and it just kind of sticks to their butts and it hangs out there. And is the easiest place to find, or easiest way to find these guys, is by finding that white waxy stuff. You will also see ant trails. Ants like to eat this white waxy stuff as it is full of good sugars for them. So it's an easy food source. And that is a problem because ants, not only in feeding on them, they don't necessarily feed on the bug, they feed on the bug's waste, but then they farm their bugs. So they will actually protect the bad bug from any predatory insects that might be in the system. So we often think about, if you're see your psyllids and they're being managed by, or being farmed by ants for their wax, we'll want to do some ant management, which is not too hard to do with some of the dooryard baits that are available even at Home Depot and Walmart. All right, so if I have the bug, what am I going to do to it? If you have a small patch of it, I would just squish it. It's actually quite satisfying. I highly recommend it. If you have more than that, you're going to want to look at some of your horticultural oils or soaps, especially in this younger life stage, which is going to be those yellowish colors. You can kill them with horticultural oil and soaps. You must read the label on the package. They must be diluted or you will burn your plant. So that is very important. I had learned this the hard way many years ago. Read that label, dilute correctly. You may have to do reapplications of it periodically because horticultural oils and soaps are not necessarily going to have the toxicity associated with what I'd put out in a production grove, but I sure as heck wouldn't use some of those chemistries in the dooryard situation. These are going to be much safer. The other really wonderful thing we can do, and I have seen some homeowners do, is supporting habitat for predators. There's lots of predatory insects and spiders that like to eat Asian citrus psyllid. So if you can support habitat that brings in some good bugs, which I'll talk about towards the end of this presentation, that would be fantastic, and they will consume them. These have been stink bugs and leaf-footed bugs have become more common pests the last 2 years. That I've been getting reports anyways. They're mobile pests, they fly around. Most people hate them because they kind of feed on everything. They've got these humongous straw-like mouth parts. They're also piercing sucking feeders. So they put their mouth part in. They have little tongue-like appendages that come out, swirl around in the plant and they suck up the juice. So they themselves make a small hole, but then that small hole leaves an opening for other stuff to get in, which leads to bigger problems. A lot of times we get the call that I have beetles in my fruit. Well, the beetles are usually a secondary or tertiary problem. Your initial problem was that these guys fed on it and then a bacteria of some sort or some type of pathogen got in that hole. And then it smelled delicious to some decaying organisms and they moved on in and took up shop. So easiest ways to watch for these, if they're a concern in your garden, and if you have like tomatoes, peppers, any other fruit crops, you're probably going to have these. They're pretty, they're not very picky eaters. They like a lot of different things. So you can look in your trees. They're pretty obvious. They're kind of big. You can use a beet sheet, which is basically just taking like a piece of paper and holding it underneath branches and knocking it with a even your broom handle. We have, you know, the more formal version of those that are like almost look like a kite that I hold underneath. How do I kill them? That's what everybody wants to know. You're not going to. You're not going to kill them. It's just not going to happen. But the ways that you can manage them is by reducing other food sources. They don't like being knocked out of the tree. So sometimes when you beat them around a little bit, one of my friends likes to take a bin of soapy water out there and just toss them in the soapy water when she finds them. And it works great. The soap breaks the water tension. They go right down to the water and drown. So it's a little brutal, but it works pretty well. And it can be very satisfying if they're causing a lot of damage. Citrus leaf miner is another huge thing we see from dooryard plantings. It's a very, very small moth. If you look at that penny, look to the right of the penny, that little bitty whitish brownish thing, that is the moth that causes, or that lays the eggs that lead to the caterpillar causing this problem. So basically what they do is they lay their egg along the mid vein of a fresh leaf. So they like flush, that's their target area. The egg hatches out, larva goes in and feeds in between the leaf surfaces. So they're gonna be really hard to remove once they're in there. For the dooryard setting, I'm getting ahead of myself. They cause damage because they mine in between the leaf surfaces. So if you look on the bottom left picture, you can see by my thumb, there's a larva right there. It's a caterpillar feeding internally. And then there's like a poop trail that goes throughout the plant. That little poop trail also has openings in it. And those openings serve as a way for canker to get into the plants. And Dr. Dudney will talk about canker in her presentation, but that can be pretty damaging to your trees. So in a dooryard situation, your best bet is gonna be removing these if you catch them early enough. Trying these, we also have pheromone lures and traps that work pretty well, but you do need to stay on top of them. They're just these little triangle traps. They have a little scent in the center of them, this little gray thing that smells like leaf miner sex pheromones, and it will attract the males out of the system so that they can't mate with the females and you have less offspring production. So they can work quite well depending on your scenario, and always pruning and removing can help immensely with these guys. Aphids are everybody's nemesis. If you garden at all, you know what an aphid is. Another piercing, sucking pest, very squishy. They can transmit some diseases. Most of the diseases in citrus that they are associated with, we don't generally have problems with, have not had for years. I don't anticipate that we'll have them again, hopefully. At least not hopefully in my time here. The damage is pretty distinct. You see those curls in the leaf structures on your left-hand side? Those curls are always aphids. There's always aphids in there. Whether they've already died or they're hanging out inside of there, they'll actually like to stay inside of that little curl and feed in that little protected area. So they're really hard to kill with sprays because they tend to be in a protected area. My first round or my first way to kill is always squishing aphids. You can tell I'm totally a bug person. I just squish them. If you have a lot of aphids, prune out the infested area. And dispose of the plant material before they spread, because they do have a high offspring production. You can also use horticultural oils or soaps. They're very effective on aphids. You need to have good coverage. Again, you need to read the label. You need to make sure you dilute it properly or you will burn your plants. They're also a favorite food for most predatory insects. They're soft, squishy bags of sugar and protein. So if you can support predators, you can probably keep them under control. They are also farmed by ants, which can be, again, controlled by ant baits. This citrus mealybug is super common on a wide variety of crops in Florida and in the dooryard situation. We actually even see them in houses when people have their plants indoors. Again, they are kind of in our common little group of small piercing sucking insects. They have those little straw-like mouth parts. They don't make as much damage as our leaf-footed bugs, but they do poke into the plant to feed. They've got a waxy outer covering. They produce a lot of honeydew, which is the sugary exudate that comes out the rear ends, and mold likes to grow on it. So you usually see the mold before you see the bug here. If you see a whole bunch of sooty mold, look up. A lot of times you're going to see some type of insect pest that is secreting honeydew. So they can cause cosmetic damage to the fruit from their feeding. With the sooty mold, you often get a reduction in photosynthesis. In production fields, we see a fruit drop in grapefruit. I would assume that would hold true in grapefruit, but we don't have as many grapefruit plantings as we did years ago, so I can't say that with 100% certainty. Again, how you find it, look for that sooty mold development, look for ant trails. Anytime you see ants running up and down your tree in a trail, there's something they're going to. You're going to find probably a pest that you're going to want to control in some manner. Killing it, horticultural oils and soaps, again, going to be your best bet. If you want something that you can just spray on them, you are going to have to reapply. The adults are harder to kill. The younger offspring of them can be much easier to control. Squish small populations. You're getting a theme here, right? I like to squish the stuff if you can, because it's easy. And supporting habitat for predators. These are actually consumed by a wide variety of our native predators in Florida. So we do have a newer mealybug on our scene. This one has started popping up in dooryard systems the past few months, and so I want to make you all aware of it. It is a non, we're calling it Lebbek mealybug. Its fancy name is Nipococcus ferritus. If you're an entomologist, we call it hibiscus mealybug, but we're in the state of Florida, so we're calling it Lebbek mealybug because that's what they chose. It's a small non-native mealybug. It's got a super duper waxy outer coating. The wax is a bit distinct from other mealybugs. On the top left there, you can see an ovisac. That's this big old ball of wax. She lays a couple hundred eggs in there, and they can be very damaging. You get cosmetic damage to fruit loss, reduction in photosynthesis from the sooty mold, branch dieback. I've seen young trees die from it, especially inside of IPCs, because they're protected once they get in there. And how do I look for it? Same with every other little bitty sugar-producing pest, sooty mold development, and ant trails. This one we really want to watch out for. So if you find it, please, please, please manage it. Don't let it go. It likes a lot of other crops too, and it's very damaging. Squish your smaller populations. You're going to know you have this if you squish it and it's purple. This is the only one we have in the state of Florida that's purple. Habitat for predators. There are a handful of predators in Florida that will consume this. Not a lot, but there are a few, and we would like to have them help us out. Trim and dispose of areas of infestation. If you have the capability of freezing these branches or burning these branches safely, that would be ideal prior to disposal. Or I guess if you burn, you don't have to dispose it because it burned. This is just a second slide on the same pest. Because it is a newer pest, we're trying to figure out where it is and what it's on. So if you do think you have the pest, you can pretty much confirm it by squishing it. And if it's purple, you got it. Please contact your local agent. Please help us in figuring out where this pest is. We've documented it in 14 counties now on 23 different hosts. And a lot of them are things that you probably want to grow in your dooryard. So if you're not able to get a hold of an agent, there is a submission site on the FDACS DPI portal. And you just go to fdacs.gov, you look for how to submit a sample. It has very specific instructions on what to do. Follow the instructions or your sample will go in the trash. That data will get back to me, and I'm working with FDACS to try to figure out this pest. So we appreciate help in documenting it. We also have several scales. Again, more small, piercing, sucking, icky pests. They have a hard shell on the adult. So when you see these harder shells, which is like that top, the white stuff on the top, and then the bottom left, it kind of looks like an oyster shell. Those hard adult shells are almost impossible to penetrate if you're going to try to kill them. You can scrape them off if you want to, but it's really challenging. High populations of these will kill young trees. They can also lead to fruit damage in certain scenarios. How you look for them, you're going to do a visual inspection of your trunks, your limbs, and even for certain varieties of scale, your fruit, sometimes your leaves. We've had a few other hard scales popping up that we don't normally see this past year. So just check your trees regularly. The adult life stage is really hard to manage, but there's a mobile life stage that we call a crawler. They're very small, they're very fast. They're little guys and they move up and down your plant. Those can actually be squished. They're easy to kill with oil. Horticultural oils are great for these. So if we want to target management actions on these, we would target those younger mobile life stages if you want to spray something with the horticultural oils and soaps. You can usually prune out areas of these. If I get them in one of my greenhouses, I just prune and send my stuff to the burn pile, and it works out very well. If it's a small tree, a lot of times you can just prune it out. Don't kill your tree by over pruning, because that'd be very sad. Soft scales are also super common. Don't be surprised, we have a variety of soft scales. The most common ones are gonna be these green and brown ones. They're small, piercing, sucking pests. They put out a lot of honeydew, so again, you're gonna see that sooty mold developing underneath them. You can look for that sooty mold or ant trails to find them, how we kill them, horticultural oils and soaps, squish the small populations. Lots of things eat these. So if you've got habitat for predators, you're going to probably be okay. Eastern liver grasshopper, I didn't realize was as big of a problem until the past 2 years when I've seen what they can do. They're very large grasshoppers. If you live in Florida, you know who they are. They defoliate a lot of plants. How do you look for them? Well, they're huge. You're not going to have to look for them. You're going to see them. And how do I kill them? So killing is almost impossible unless you're going to do something illegal, and we're not going to recommend that. So the way I normally do it is I just stomp on them. Not pretty, but it works. Nothing likes to eat them. Stomp on them if you got to. The IPCs that Fernando mentioned earlier are actually fantastic for keeping these off. I've seen them in groves where we have high populations, and the only trees that aren't damaged are the ones that had the IPCs on them. Orange jawed caterpillars, this is usually more of a dooryard issue than it is in a production grove for us. So these are caterpillars, they're fun little caterpillars. They have these things that we call osmeteria, they're kind of like horns. If you make them mad, they pop them out of their head, they're bright red and they smell bad. I find them very cute, but I think most people don't because they're huge defoliators. So how you can find them is you're gonna look for large areas of chewed spots on your leaves. So they basically just wanna chew on your leaves and develop. And then they become this gorgeous butterfly. So the butterfly we love because it's a pollinator, but the juveniles, the caterpillars, we don't love because they're defoliators. You can also look for poop accumulation. It's gonna look like little pebbles. So if you see an area of like little greenish, brownish pebbles that don't look like anything else around, look up, you probably have some type of caterpillar, and it tends to be orange jogs because they love our trees. The easiest way and the most efficient way to kill these guys is just physical removal. Get a bin of soapy water, grab them, toss them in, they'll drown and die. Spider mites are also a major problem, especially if you have indoor plants or if you have them on your porch. They really like the drier habitats. So if they tend to be in an area that's super duper duper dry, you're probably gonna get spider mite flare-ups. They're very tiny. Usually we don't see them until we start seeing spots on the leaves or we see kind of webbing between our leaves. That webbing is indicative that you probably have spider mites. Most of you are not going to see them with your naked eye. You might see some dots moving on the webbing. So leaf damage, you're going to see spots. They can defoliate at high populations. The spots that we call are stippling. Ways that we control them, you can knock them off with water. They really hate moisture. So like in my greenhouse, we actually mostly control spider mites by taking our hose and watering up from underneath into the foliage to knock them down and creating a nice moist habitat around our leaves, and that prevents a lot of buildup of them. We get them every now and then, but they really don't like those moist areas. So that's gonna be your goal. Knock them out of your canopy if possible. You can use horticultural oils to work to control them also. It smothers their eggs and offspring. But the first line of defense is prevention, and that's just me knocking them off with water. Rust mites can be problematic. They do a lot of damage to your fruit. So on your left, you can see teeny tiny mites, which I guarantee, unless you have the most amazing eyesight, you will never see these with the naked eye. But you'll know they're there because you're gonna see some damage on your fruit in the form of bronzing, which is the picture in the middle, or shark skin damage on the bottom. So if it's a dooryard tree, honestly, you could totally eat the fruit that had the bronzing. They're gonna taste just fine. They might be a little bit sweeter because you do get a little more sugar accumulation with that damage. The shark skin ones are going to be gnarly, just toss them out. They're very small mites, they cause rind damage. You can get reduced fruit set if you have a super high population, which we don't see as much as I've seen in literature in the past. How we look for them is we actually scout our fruit. We use a little lens and look for it, but it's going to be really hard to do in a dooryard situation. So to be completely honest, I would probably just make sure you're watering your tree canopy. I would use horticultural oils periodically because that does keep their populations down. And we also do have some naturally occurring predatory fungi, which is really cool. We see more of that in the dooryard habitats than in the groves, and those can be really helpful for controlling these. All right, so I told you I was going to talk a little bit about good bugs. So I am a huge fan of predators, and in that dooryard situation, they are the ideal way to manage your pests. So when I'm talking about good bugs or predatory bugs, and I'm going to lump spiders in, so I'm sorry for my fellow entomologists, that's painful, but for my purposes, spiders are bugs. Spiders will eat almost anything and everybody, so we want to support our spiders where possible. I know most people hate them. Minute pirate bugs, which are I don't know if my pointer is going to work, but they're on the bottom. second to the right-hand side of the screen. He has a little pokey mouth part going into a scale there. They are great predators. People hate them because they think they're pooking on them, but really they'll stand on you for a minute. They'll go off and look for other food. Long-legged flies, which is smack in the middle, those bright iridescent little flies, they tend to be blue, green, or black, and they're super shiny. We have a yellow variety in Florida too. They are great predators of all things soft and squishy. Lady beetles, which is going to be your bottom left. Those are two adults and then a juvenile lady beetle, which they have different colors, sizes, slightly different shapes occasionally. They will eat almost anything soft and squishy. Earwigs, which are on the bottom right, you can see the rear end of an earwig hanging out of a mealybug pile. They eat a lot of things too. They're not particularly picky. So if you can have habitat that supports these guys, it's going to be some type of resource, some floral resources, some things that might have, I know we don't necessarily want pests, but you know, if you can have a low density of aphids and that those floral resources, you're probably going to get some good predators in there. We also, so these guys I all showed up here are generalists. They'll eat almost anything. We also have a subset called specialist predators. And so we talk about these a lot because in Florida, well, I'm going to talk about the first one, which is the mealybug destroyer on the top right. The picture on the left, those are the juvenile, the larval stage of mealybug destroyer, which is a lady beetle, a very tiny lady beetle. And on the far right is the adult lady beetle. They specialize on mealybugs. Shocking, their name is mealybug destroyers. They are one of the best predators that we have in our state for mealybugs, and they do very well on that new mealybug species that we're figuring out. So if you have these, if you see the guys in the middle there, the white long stringies, please don't squish them. They're very good predators. Also Tamarix irradiata. This is the predator that has been reared by FDACs for quite a while. And it's an introduced predator. It preys on Asian citrusilla nymphs. So in the picture on the bottom right, you can see the remnants of an Asian citrusilla nymph, which is the juvenile stage that was molting into an adult. And then right above it, there is a little wasp that has emerged. And basically they eat the bug, the bad bug from the inside out, which is awesome and something like out of a horror movie, which I think is super cool. If you have citrus trees in your dooryard, you can get Tamarix irradiata from FDACs from the rearing facility. They specifically rear them mostly for use in dooryard settings. All right, so some other control options we have here. I keep talking about creating habitat for predators. We call these cultural controls. And so basically you're gonna wanna have some plants there that they can move into and live off of and have some resources to actually stay in your yard instead of just coming in and eating and leaving and then get another pest and that's not a great model. You can do mechanical removal. I'm a big fan of that soapy water bin and throwing things in it when you can just to kill stuff. Insects will go through the soapy water, they'll drown. Then you can just dispose of that properly. The Tamarixia, like I said, are available from the FDACS DPI dooryard program. We do have some insecticides that are available at the store. I personally, you've heard me mention a bunch of times, the horticultural oils and soaps are very good options for homeowners. Read the label. It'll tell you how to dilute it. It will tell you how often to spray it. But for a lot of those piercing, sucking, soft, squishy critters, this is a great material to use. The particle films can work very well. Also, you do need to pay attention to how quickly they wash off in rains. So there was some data in commercial settings where one of our researchers was looking at kaolin, and it does a pretty darn good job of deterring Asian citrusillas from establishing. So diatomaceous earth, kaolin, these are great tools for a lot of these piercing sucking bugs, but you do have to stay on top of application. And there's a handful of insecticides that are available for home use. Again, read the label. It's a mixed bag. Some are really great, some really aren't. Coverage is always gonna be important. So make sure you're following that label, make sure you're getting really good coverage of your plant if you're gonna use them. Get the most bang for your buck there. So cover all the surfaces and just follow that label as far as reapplication periods. And that's it. That's all I got. So I can take some questions.
Great. I am taking over for Wendy. She had to jump off for another meeting. So thank you, Lauren. We have some comments and a couple of questions. So
I just thought about it. I'm sorry. I forgot to mention the IPC stuff.
Please do.
Fernando mentioned earlier about IPCs for keeping Asian citrus psyllid out. They're very effective at keeping Asian citrus psyllid out. As long as you don't have any leaves poking out the side of your IPCs, which will happen if the plant gets too big. But we have seen other pests that get into the bags. So anything that's small enough to get through the mesh or go up underneath it. We've seen that newer mealybug get in there. We've seen mites get inside, several species of caterpillars. I think the moths and butterflies are laying eggs on the surface and they're dropping in. So we do see some pests that get into those IPC bags. So IPC bags are great, but if you're going to use them, make sure you're checking them. Make sure you're looking for stuff that's getting in there, because you definitely want to get on top of an issue before you lose a plant. Sorry, thank you.
Oh, great. And we have about 4 minutes. So I'm going to just go through a couple comments that were in the chat, like from Jamie Lynn Doherty. We have, for lubbers in the juvenile stage, we used a wet dry vac to collect them into soapy water. She said it worked great in her garden. And then Danielle Sprague is feeding her orange dogs to her chickens. Yvonne says she put the adult lubbers in, I think, a peanut butter jar and froze or dunked them into a soapy water jar. So these are all wonderful techniques.
Those are fantastic.
I think. Yeah. Susan Griffin mentioned that she kept a native wild lime tree to put orange dog caterpillars on so they don't have to kill future butterflies. I don't know about that. Yeah.
And then that's a good idea.
Good. Anna Redondo said horticultural oil can be, for example, is that neem oil? If I use neem oil or any other oil, am I affecting the good predators?
So anytime you put anything out, you have the potential of affecting your predators also. Neem oil doesn't tend to have too many impacts on predatory insects. They do kind of scent. So if you look on this screen, actually on the bottom left, there's just this general horticultural oil. And it's got a little bit of everything in it. It does have some neem in it. So you always have a chance of affecting predators. That's just a reality if you manage the pests. But a lot of these are a lot softer than, so if I really cared about my predators, I probably would not put 7 in my garden. I would probably use horticultural oil or soap. They don't have a long residual, so they don't stick around a long time after I put them out there. And so the impact would be minimized. That would be my personal preference. I don't use any insecticides on my plants. I will only any of the like synthetic or even organic insecticides. I will use the oils and I will use the soaps. That's for my personal use. That's what I use at home.
Yeah. I think that's what Dr. Rogers was also referring to in the beginning of the session about that. We're not really big on pesticides in the home landscape. So especially
because 7 is toxic to, that's one of the few things you can get at the store. And it's also toxic to vertebrates. So we want to be careful what we put out there because there's pets and children that run around, you know, yards.
Exactly. So here's another one from Barbara Edmonds. Given hard shell scale, Liebig millibug, and damage from lubbers, are IPCs preferred or is it more effective to rely on beneficial predators and parasitoids and routine scouting?
I'd say stay tuned because we're still learning how to work with IPCs. We can't talk about it just yet, but we do have a grant coming to do some of this research. So stay tuned on that one. Give me at least a year, maybe two, to give you a good answer there.
Great. And then I think the last one we have is from Manji. How do you squish psyllids? That's a great question.
My thumb.
We're going to do a video on Dr. Diepenbrock squishing psyllids. So we can.
I actually have pictures of all the different mealybug colors when I squish them. So I can tell you who's who based on color. Some of them I can, not all of them, but I'm working on it.
I think that's something that goes on our agenda. So with that, I'm going to turn it back.
Hang on, Ruth. There's one question that was raised, I think is pertinent. Somebody asked about using imidacloprid and whether or not that was recommended.
Great, thank you.
What would you say about that?
I probably wouldn't use it in a dooryard, to be completely honest. I mean, especially given some of the concerns of it. If you know what you're doing, you could use it, but for a general homeowner who does not use insecticides would not like necessarily know how to store it properly, necessarily know how to apply it properly, it may not be their best bet. And I might change my mind on that in a year after we've done this research. But right now, from what I've seen in my interactions, I don't think it's the safest option.
Great. Thanks, Fred, for bringing that up. I missed that one. So great. So now I'm going to turn it back over to Fernando, and I think we have Dr. Dooney up next.